Good morning all. Here we are to start our webinar, international webinar on graphene-based fast searchable observable devices and their application to more locking of solid state lasers by Dr. Isim Subbaylam. She is a researcher from KOC University, Turkey. She completed her MS and PhD from the same university. And she is focusing on the development of ultra-fast near and mid-infrared solid-state lasers, graphene-based nanomaterials, and their use as searchable absorbers to generate femtosecond pulses from solid-state lasers. So she has also completed her doctoral research from same university, KOC University, on Surface Science and Technology Center. And a supervisor ultra-fast laser spectroscopy laboratory in KUYTAM, and she is a member of Optical Society of America and International Society of Optics and Photonics, that is SPI. And during her OSA and SPI student memberships, she had received Outstanding Student Oral Presentation Award in both 2015 and 2016. And now she is working as a researcher in the KOC University. She has one more thing about her academics is she has been selected to serve as one of the 2019 ambassadors of the OSA, and she was an alumnae of the 69th Lindo Laurel Laureate meeting. And now she will be presenting a talk on graphene-based fast searchable absorber devices and their application to mode locking of solid-state lasers. On behalf of MMOC, Memo College Student Chapter, and Mohammed Abdul Rahman Memorial Orphanage College, I welcome Dr. Isim Subbaylam to present a talk on her research work, and I thank for giving an opportunity to listen to her talk. I please have a start your session. Thank you.
Thank you for the very kind, nice introduction, Dr. Sahir. I'm really pleased to give this presentation. I hope I could make this in person, but you know, these are the hard times. So I will just start with present now and then open my PowerPoint here. This is actually first time for me, Google Meet. I used Zoom before. Can you still hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. You can start. If any problem comes, I will let you know. Okay, you can start.
Okay, now I'm starting. Again, thank you for inviting me. It was a really nice opportunity to give this presentation to your student chapter. Today, I will talk about graphene-based fast searchable absorber devices and their application to mode locking of solid state lasers. But first, I will start with introduction of where I conducted this study. Although currently I'm in the United States, I'm visiting my friends, I did all of these studies in Istanbul, Turkey. Here you can see Turkey, our country, a little bit close to India. And this is the zoom in version of it. Istanbul is here. It connects Europe and Asia. It connects two continents. We have the Black Sea here, Marmara Sea, Aegean Sea, and Mediterranean here in Turkey. So this is a photograph taken from International Space Station. You can clearly see that here is the Bosphorus, which separates Europe continent and the Asia continent, Black Sea and Marmara Sea. And these are the bridges which connect Europe to the Asia. So we can basically say that in Istanbul you can go from Asia to Europe, Europe to Asia on a daily basis. It is easy. And you can see one of the pictures of this bridge. It's a very nice city. And our university, Koç University, is located here, very close to the Black Sea region of the Istanbul. You can see our university. This is the Koç University. And I completed my master's and PhD degrees in this university, and there is a research center located in Koç University, which is called as Koç University Surface Science and Technology Center. I conducted my postdoctoral activities as a supervisor of the ultrafast laser research laboratory at KUYTAM. You can see the photographs of our devices located in this ultra-fast laser laboratory. We have an 800 nanometer 100 femtoseconds 4 watts laser here. We use it for microfabrication or time-resolved pump probe spectroscopy experiments. And we also have a fluorescence spectrometer, which can perform experiments from UV up to mid-infrared. You can measure the lifetimes in the nanosecond range. Here, you can measure lifetimes in the femtosecond, picosecond range by looking at the change in the absorption. With this setup, they are complementary. You can measure the lifetime in the nanosecond up to microsecond range. And it uses the fluorescence emission for the lifetime measurement. Okay, this was the introduction. So today, as I said, I will talk about graphene-based saturable absorbers and their use for femtosecond pulse generation. First, I will start with why graphene is so popular and what are graphene-based supercapacitors. Then I will continue with our motivation for the study. I will stop at this point and give you some idea about characteristics of the ultra-short pulses and saturable absorbers. Then I will one by one explain our experiments conducted with this specific kind of saturable absorber. And in the last part of my presentation, I will show to you our pump probe results, our ultrafast spectroscopy results conducted with this ultrafast system here for the graphene-based saturable absorbers, supercapacitor saturable absorbers. First of all, probably you all know that graphene is very popular. Andrei Geim and Konstantin Novoselov, for example, won the Nobel Prize in Physics in 2010 for their experiments regarding to graphene material. But why it is important? It is a very thin material. It is an atomic layer thin. So it is very thin two-dimensional material. Although it is very thin, it is strong. As far as I know, it is stronger than steel and it is a very good conductor. It conducts heat and electricity better than gold. These are again, as far as I know. And I put this photograph here of me with Konstantin Novoselov because maybe you wanna take note. This was taken at Lindau Nobel Laureate meeting in 2019. It is a very nice meeting. I certainly suggest to you apply to this conference. It is a scientific conference, but there are nearly 600 researchers and students, undergraduate students, graduate students, and postdoctoral researchers can apply for this event. And there are 600 people all around the world. And there are around 30 Nobel laureates in physics. This meeting is, it happens every year, but in different disciplines. For example, this 2019 was physics, then 2020 is supposed to be economy, and it continues like chemistry, medicine, like that. I definitely suggest that because you have an opportunity of listen talks from the actual Nobel laureates, and they give you opportunity to have breakfasts, lunch, dinners with them. It was an excellent experience for me. So consider this meeting in your life. And if you want to learn more about graphene, because graphene is not my area of expertise, I'm a solid state laser physicist, you can refer to this article. It is very easy to understand. It is written by one of the Nobel laureates, Konstantin Novoselov, Materials in the Flatland. Flatland here refers to the two-dimensional materials. So you can learn about other two-dimensional materials also in this article. So let's come to the optical properties of graphene because we are dealing with the optical properties in the solid-state lasers. So this is the energy band diagram of graphene. As you can see, it has a linear dispersion relation, and because of its linear energy bound structure and its Fermi level lies in the Dirac point, which means that this is occupied up to this point, it has a constant, nearly constant absorption, very broadband absorption, starting from visible up to mid-infrared, even other longer wavelengths. And the beautiful thing is that this broadband absorption can be expressed in terms of fundamental physical constants, pi times alpha, fine structure constant, and one layer graphene single pass broadband absorption equals to 2.3%, which is actually a very strong amount of absorption for an atomic layer thick material. So it is a really a unique property for graphene. Because of this strong and broadband absorption, graphene is visible to naked eye. Even a monolayer of graphene, I'm not sure if you can clearly see it or not. This is a monolayer graphene on top of a glass substrate, and you can see it with your naked eye, but don't forget it, it is an atomic layer thick material, very thin material. And this is three-layer graphene. You can more easily see that because as you add layers, its absorption amount increases. So it is again becomes more visible to naked eye. So this is one of the most beautiful properties of graphene, broadband, nearly constant absorption. But there are also other unique optical properties, nonlinear properties, which is important to produce short pulses from lasers. One of them is the carrier lifetime of graphene. This is the lifetime graph. And one of them is the saturation fluence of graphene, saturation characteristics of graphene. Basically, that makes it a very good saturable absorber. From the lifetime, we can say that it is quite short. This is the recombination lifetime. Let me explain it this way. When you pump, for example, graphene, you excite one electron from here to here, and this measures the recombination time. The electron comes from here to the Fermi level and recombines again. So this gives you that lifetime, 1.5 picoseconds. It is around usually 5 picoseconds, and it changes graphene to graphene because it depends on the production quality. To generate femtosecond pulses, this saturable absorber lifetime, this carrier recombination lifetime, should be fast. By fast, I mean that it should be smaller than the cavity round trip time of the photon, so that when one photon sees graphene and travels through the cavity again it should be recombined back so that it can excite it again. So if you consider a nanosecond, hundreds of nanoseconds cavity round trip time inside a laser cavity, this is quite short and it can help you to produce short pulses. And here you can see the saturation graph of graphene. Here, this graph means that when you increase the incident fluence on graphene one by one up to a level, its transmission increases, so it becomes transparent. It is also an important property of saturable absorbers to act as a very fast shutter inside a laser resonator. So again, when a photon comes, excites, of course, you should have an intensity of photons, which is determined by the saturation intensity. So if your photon intensity is higher than this one, it will saturate the graphene, and graphene becomes transparent for a very short time. So when it travels and comes back again, it will be recombined, defined by this recombination lifetime, and again it will not be transparent. So this process goes on like this. I will explain it more clearly with a very short video taken during an experiment. So basically, this transmission graphs show that your graphene can act as a very fast shutter. It can become transparent after a certain fluence level, and then it can be opaque again, so that it will behave like a shutter. It will be like on and off for the photons. It modulates the loss inside the cavity in this way. Okay, after the optical properties of graphene that we used in our experiments, let's talk about the fabrication technique of graphene. This is one of the very common fabrication techniques, and it is quite easy. Our graphene samples and graphene-based supercapacitors were fabricated at Bilkent University. It is another university in another city of Turkey. By the group of Professor Coşkun Kocabaş. So they have a furnace like that, and they, I don't know, heat it up to 1000 Celsius degrees. They put a glass tube, and inside there is a copper foil, and they use methane as a carbon source. So there are certain fabrication parameters. Then after some time passes, you will have graphene grown on top of copper. Then to protect graphene, you spin coat it with a photoresist, and then you will stamp it by using a polymer called PDMS on copper foil. As a result, you will have copper substrate with graphene and photoresist, as can be seen here. In order to get rid of PDMS and copper, I'm sorry, in order to get rid of this copper, you put it in a ferrochlorure solution. Then you will be left with PDMS and graphene. After this point, you can, like a stamp, you can put your graphene on top of glass, for example. You can stick it on glass or, I don't know, silicon, maybe quartz, sapphire, any kind of substrate. So this is the fabrication method. Again, this is also another important property of graphene because it is very easy to produce compared to other semiconductor materials which require very complex fabrication techniques, molecular beam epitaxy techniques, high, I don't know, advanced laboratories, clean rooms. This is just all one furnace, copper, your carbon source, and any other small equipments, and you can get graphene. And in this Nobel laureate meeting, one of the Nobel laureates called graphene as a democracy material because of that. So you don't have to be a rich laboratory to produce graphene. Even you can produce graphene with a scotch tape. Maybe you know this method. You have graphite, lots of graphene layers, like basically it is also a carbon made graphite. So you put a scotch tape on top of graphite and you just peel it. You can have after certain peeling levels, monolayer graphene. It is also explained in their paper. So as a result of its unique optical properties, linear and nonlinear optical properties, and relatively simple growth schemes, graphene has been used to generate ultra short pulses from different lasers. These red ones are our group's contributions to the literature. So since it has a very broadband absorption, you can clearly see that in the near infrared, in the mid infrared, you can use graphene as a saturable absorber. If you have another saturable absorber, which is called as CSAM, semiconductor saturable absorber mirror, since it is based on a semiconductor and it has a certain band gap, you cannot use one CSAM in many different lasers, but you can use one graphene in different lasers because it has a broadband absorption due to its linear energy band diagram. So it has been used in many different lasers, as we can see here. But of course, there are certain challenges with graphene. One of them is the nearly constant absorption of 5% in the round trip pass inside the cavity. So it can be tolerable for some lasers, but if you have a very low gain laser, or you have problems with power, very low power laser, it will be a problem. So you have to change the loss of graphene. But how it is possible? Because it is already a monolayer material. It is an atomic layer thick. You cannot cut it into half. You cannot reduce its thickness because it is already an atomic layer thick. But you can play with its Fermi level. So people suggested that this is the monolayer graphene energy band diagram. Fermi level is here. So as I explained previously, a photon comes. You can excite one electron from here to the conduction band. So it is absorbed. If you play with the Fermi level, for example, if you increase it here, if this atom comes, if this photon comes again and tries to excite the carrier from here to here, it will be occupied. So as a result of the Pauli exclusion principle, you cannot excite this electron from here to here. So it won't be absorbed. So it becomes transparent. If you move the Fermi level up to this point, it will become transparent for the photon energies up to this point. If you have a larger photon energy, you can excite it, still you can excite it from here to here. But for a certain photon energy, it will be transparent. So for this purpose, people suggested different approaches. One of them is you can chemically dope graphene, you can n-doped or p-doped graphene to obtain a Fermi level shift. But at the end, you will have a fixed shift in the Fermi level because it's a chemical process. So you will have a fixed change in absorption, which means that you cannot use this graphene in many different lasers. It can be, it becomes a fabricated material for a certain wavelength. So to overcome this, people also suggested electrostatically doped graphene structures, which are called as solid state graphene based capacitors. So with this approach, you can have reversible shift in the Fermi level, of course, reversible change in absorption. But since they use solid state materials between the graphene electrodes as a conductor material, it requires very high operating voltages to shift the Fermi level above the visible wavelength photon energies, for example. So if you apply a lot of voltage to that structure, you can damage your supercapacitor. So the challenges with this electrostatically doped graphene capacitors are high operating voltages and, as a result, limited operation wavelengths. For example, in this paper, they use a solid state graphene capacitor, but they use it only for 1.5 micron because they cannot apply more voltage to change Fermi level to the visible photon energies. So how a graphene supercapacitor works? What is the difference between a solid state capacitor and supercapacitor? Let's talk about it. So in a supercapacitor, not only for graphene, you have these two electrodes. In our case, these are graphene. This is one graphene. This is another graphene. In between, you have a dielectric liquid. Instead of a solid state material, you have a dielectric liquid this time. So you apply a voltage. After you apply a voltage, you polarize this dielectric liquid. And then not the whole structure acts as a capacitor. These layers, they are called electrical double layers. This minus, this is polarized minus, and you have plus here because of the electrolyte. This very small electrical double layers itself, they act as a capacitor. And this length is determined by this ion radius. So it is a very small, very tiny capacitor with nanometers thick. So maybe you remember from the basic physics, if you have a slab-like capacitor, and if the separation between the capacitor is very, very small, you can obtain very high electric fields by applying only few volts of bias. For example, 1 or 2 volts of bias, you can obtain very large electric fields. As a result, you can shift Fermi level infrared up to the visible wavelengths. You can shift it more because you don't have the risk of damaging the structure here. So this is the advantage of a supercapacitor, and in especially for the graphene-based supercapacitor. So our collaborators at Beacon University fabricated two different devices. But first, we started with this initial device. Similar to this drawing, we had graphene electrodes here. We have the electrolyte. You apply a voltage. We call this device as voltage-controlled graphene Saturable Absorber. Then we improved our design. We also removed one of the other graphene electrodes to reduce its loss even further. So in this voltage controlled graphene gold saturable absorber, VCG gold SI structure, we have a graphene electrode, again same electrolyte, but as a second electrode we have gold here, and we have a notch on this gold so that a light beam can easily travel through this structure. So this device is called as VCG SA. This is VCG gold SA, short versions of their names. So let me continue with our motivation. We have these devices, but chronologically, first we had this device, then we improved to this design. So what was our motivation? Of course, the first motivation was to investigate the voltage-dependent optical characteristics of such graphene-based supercapacitors. By the way, people have been using these graphene-based supercapacitors in electronics applications or any other photonics applications. But this was the first time for literature to investigate the optical characteristics of such devices. So it was our main motivation. And during my PhD laboratory, we had many different lasers from visible to mid-infrared. So we had a chance to use different lasers to test the performance of this device as a saturable absorber to check whether it can enable femtosecond pulse generation or not. And we had available two different lasers. One of them was Thai Sapphire laser, and the other one was chromium-doped Forstright laser. Both of them are solid-state lasers. And it is a very good motivation. It was a very good motivation for us because both lasers have very nice biomedical applications. You are probably familiar with the Thai Sapphire laser operating around 800 nanometer. It is commonly used in many applications, material processing, biomedical imaging, two photon microscopy, many different applications. But this chromium Forstright is less known laser. It operates around 1.3 micron. It is again another solid state laser, chromium doped Forstright crystal. But it has also very important biomedical applications. If you look at this window here, given in this graph, there are four windows for biomedical applications. This is the first window, this is the second window, and this is the absorbance of water, which is very important for imaging application because water absorbs light, and if it absorbs a lot, you cannot obtain deep tissue images, or you will have noisy results. So water absorption is crucial for imaging. If you look at this window here, second window, chromium Forstright is a very good laser to use it for multi-photon imaging or any other biomedical imaging application, because you can avoid water absorption. Water absorption is quite low here. These are the tissue lengths, for example. And you can also get rid of Rayleigh scattering compared to Thai Sapphire laser. You know, Rayleigh scattering changes with the inverse fourth power of the wavelength. So if your wavelength is shorter, you will have a large amount of Rayleigh scattering. So since this wavelength is higher than this one, you can get away from the Rayleigh scattering. But for example, if you go this point, you will have then absorption problems. So it is a very good candidate to use as a source in imaging applications. So these two lasers are very important to check, to improve their femtosecond pulse generating abilities. And this point, as I said, I will briefly describe some of the characteristics of ultra-short laser pulses and saturable absorbers to give you some idea about before going into our experimental results. Here you can see very basic laser resonator. In its simplest form, a laser resonator consists of two highly reflecting mirrors and a gain medium, which gives you the optical amplification. This gain medium, in the case of solid state lasers, is a solid material. It can be ion doped, glass, ceramic, or crystal. In our case, both lasers were ion doped crystals. One of them is titanium doped sapphire, and the other one was chromium doped forstrite crystal. So, in such a laser resonator, this is called as the cavity round trip time. L is the cavity length and C is the speed of light. So this is the cavity round trip time for the photons resonating in such a laser resonator. So we can call this laser, for example, as a continuous wave laser if its output power does not change with time. But at the same time, you have many different randomly oscillating modes between these two mirrors. And if you somehow able to lock the phases of these modes, you can obtain very short pulses in the time domain, in the femtosecond, picosecond range, and you will have a broader spectrum in the space domain. And if your pulses are solitary optical pulses, which means that as they travel, they preserve their energy, they are specific kind of ultra-short laser pulses, you can relate your pulse duration with your spectrum by using this equation. For example, for an ideal solitary optical pulse, its mathematical profile is like Sach square, as you can see here. This constant equals to 0.315. This equation is called as time bandwidth product, which is an important parameter to define ultra-short optical pulses. So this is the time bandwidth product of the femtosecond pulses in Sach square form. So if you look at, for example, an oscilloscope image like that, this is the cavity round trip time in terms of nanoseconds and hertz. It is also called as the repetition rate of a laser. You can see the equation here. It is speed of light, inverse of this equation, speed of light divided by 2 times cavity length. This is called as the repetition rate of the laser. And also to characterize a laser pulse, you have energy per pulse, which is output power divided by the repetition rate. So how much energy is distributed in each pulses here. And other parameter is peak power of the pulse, which equals to energy per pulse divided by the pulse duration. So these are the basic equations to describe an ultra-short laser pulse. Time bandwidth product, repetition rate, energy per pulse, peak power per pulse. These are the very basic equations. But there are also any other factors in ultra-short laser pulses. Since you are dealing with high peak power pulses, you will encounter some nonlinear effects inside your resonator. One of them is nonlinear Kerr effect, which is defined as N equals to low intensity refractive index is the normal refractive index of the material. You all know from the textbooks. This is the nonlinear refractive index of the material, which changes with the intensity. If you have high intensity pulses, you also have this factor in your laser resonator. So this nonlinear Kerr effect can cause two different phenomena. One of them is in the space domain and the other one is in the time domain. In the space domain, you will have self-focusing. So if you consider your pulse shape as a Gaussian here, for example, its intensity will be higher here at the peak, lower here. So consider this one as a laser crystal, Thai sapphire, for example. In every pass, whenever this laser pulse passes to this material, as a result of this Kerr effect, it will be focused more and more. So, and this material, your crystal, will act as a positive lens, so it will be focused more and more. This phenomena is called as self-focusing. But up to a limit, it is not an unlimited focusing. And this limit is called as the critical power, which is defined as alpha. It is a constant, not important. lambda square divided by 8 pi regular refractive index times the nonlinear refractive index of the material. This is called as the critical power. So it puts a limit to the self-focusing. But if you go further and further, you increase your peak power or you reduce your duration of your ultra short pass, of course you will overcome this limit. You will continue to self-focus your pass more and more, but then you will encounter damages. You will eventually damage your material here, and you will not obtain, before damaging, you will also see some instabilities in your laser pulses. This is very important because, as you all know, the Nobel Prize in Physics in 2018 was given to Donna Strickland and Gerard Moreau because of their technique of chirp pulse amplification. In this technique, they cleverly overcome this limitation. So because for some applications at the end, you want ultra short pulses and high peak powers at the same time. So what you do, you have a ultra short laser, for example, producing 200 femtosecond pulses. Before you don't want to amplify your pulse inside the resonator. You don't want to put more and more input powers because you can damage your material, you can damage your optics. You do it like that. You have your 200 femtosecond pulses. You send those pulses to an external amplifier. You amplify there. It makes some turns in another laser resonator. You have an amplifier. Then you externally compress your pulse. You do not compress your pulse inside your laser resonator. You have your pulse. You amplify it again in the amplifier stage. Then externally, by using gratings, for example, you compress your pulse. So at the end, you will have, for example, 10 femtosecond pulses with 4 watts. But it is not possible, for example, for you to obtain such a power level and peak power pulse duration in a laser resonator because you can damage your materials. So it's a very important technique. So in summary, we have ultra short laser pulses, and they have high peak powers because their durations are very short. We encounter nonlinear effects, Kerr effect, which is called as Kerr effect, and in the space domain it causes self-focusing. So you have a limitation for your pulse duration and peak power. Similarly, in the time domain it causes self-phase modulation. As you go through your material again, your crystal, for example, again, your crystal will add to your pulse a positive dispersion. It will act like a positive dispersion material. So eventually it will broaden your pulse in the time domain. Your pulse is in its each pass through the gain medium, it will become longer and longer in the time domain. So you don't want this. So in order to overcome this self-phase modulation effect, you add negative dispersion inside your laser resonator to balance this positive dispersion coming from self-phase modulation or other, for example, coming from air, coming from mirrors, other materials. If you do it, if you carefully balance the dispersion inside your cavity, then you obtain solitary optical pulses, as I mentioned before, which obey this Solitonnerea theorem. Here, W is the cavity energy, D is the net dispersion, plus minus negative dispersions. Gamma is the nonlinearity factor, which depends on the material type. Is it Thai sapphire, is it chromium forsyte? And tau zero is the pulse duration times 1.76. It is another constant. They all have mathematical proofs. If you are interested, you can check this article, for example, by Hauss, mode locking of lasers. So this equation basically a roadmap equation. For example, if you want that much of energy and that much of pulse duration, how much dispersion you should add to your laser resonator. But of course, you should also know the gamma factor of your material, or your material's gamma factor is unknown, you obtain pulses somehow, you were lucky, and you can measure your pulse energy and pulse duration. You know how much dispersion you added to the cavity. You can then find out experimentally the gamma factor of your material, for example. So it is a good equation. And if we continue with the, again, ultra-short laser pulse characteristics, in one of the first slides, I briefly talked about saturable absorbers. So here we are doing saturable absorber mode locking, which means that we have an absorber inside our resonator to lock the phases of our randomly oscillating modes. So this one was the one of the important properties of the saturable absorber, as I explained. As I said to you, so you have a transmission here for the material, for example. This is the linear transmission, no fluence or very low fluence. As you increase the fluence on your saturable absorber, it becomes transparent. But up to a certain point, it becomes fully transparent and you do not observe much change in the transmission of the saturable absorber. So this is called as the saturation point, so saturation fluence of your saturable absorber. And after you fully saturate your absorber, this transmission amount minus its regular transmission will give you the modulation depth of the saturable absorber, which means that how much loss it can introduce to your cavity. I explained before, it will act like a shutter. So unsaturated loss will be that much and saturated loss will be that much, and difference will give you the modulation depth. So how much can you modulate the loss inside your laser cavity? There's a video, maybe it will make you more clear for you. I will also show that. In the, for example, specific case of graphene saturable absorber, without changing Fermi level, you can forget about the voltage here. You have incoming photon flux. So let's say it is their fluence is above the saturation fluence. So you can excite that much of carriers from here to here. So until they recombine again, since now carriers are here, this graphene will become transparent for the same photon energy. So it can pass easily, which makes it act as a shutter. So you excite, before they recombine back, it will be transparent, but it should also recombine very fast, because in the other turn, photon should do the same thing, so that it can regularly turn on and off the loss amount in your laser cavity. And eventually, your laser will prefer the low loss operation mode, so it will start to produce pulses continuously. It will not no longer operate as a continuous wave laser. It will act as a pulse laser, because it will prefer the low loss operation mode. This animation clearly summarizes what I said. You have your laser resonator, you have your gain medium, you put your saturable absorber here. It becomes transparent and produce pulses. So in this video, 15 milliwatt is the output power while it is pulsing. It is femtoseconds. Now it is not femtosecond, it is 7 milliwatts. As you see here, so this is not pulsing mode. It sees more loss. Graphene is not transparent. But in the pulsing mode, since pulses have higher energy compared to higher power compared to continuous wave mode, graphene becomes transparent and it produces femtosecond pulses with higher output powers. See it again, this is the mode-locked laser, 15 milliwatts. If you disturb mode-locking, it is 7 milliwatts and continuous wave laser. So we talked about importance of graphene very basic characteristics of ultra short pulses, some optical properties of graphene, all these topics, this nonlinear effects, self phase modulation, self focusing, they have very nice articles, papers. They are huge concepts. So we just I just tried to summarize these concepts to you because I use some of the equations in my experimental results. Let's start with our first experiment, which used voltage-controlled graphene, two graphene electrode supercapacitor structure, and chromium phosphide laser. You can see the experimental setup here. We pumped this chromium phosphide crystal with a ytterbium fiber at 1064 nanometer. We have a lens for focusing, and this is the X cavity resonator. OC here stands for the output coupler, and 2.4% means that in each turn it will extract 2.4% of the total intracavity power. So we had some tricks in this laser. First, we remove this high reflector and then this output coupler. Here we added, which is called as multipass cavity. It is an extension, very unique extension. I will explain the purpose of this extension. So in this cavity, by the way, the total cavity length became 60 meters after this addition, but this was separated like 1 meter or something like that. It was half of the optical table, but the total length was 60 meters. How is that possible? You inject your light from here. It makes multiple bounces between these mirrors. You eject it from here. These mirrors have some notches, and you complete the last turn by using this structure here, and it goes back like that. Why we use this multipass cavity? Remember that repetition rate of your laser depends on the cavity length. So if you increase the cavity length, you will reduce the repetition rate. If you reduce the repetition rate at the same output power without increasing your pump power, you can obtain higher pulse energies according to this equation. So this extension was added in order to obtain high peak power, high energy per pulse at the same average output power. It was very simple. You just extend your cavity. In this part, we added a bunch of dispersion control optics because specific to chromium phosphide, it is N2. I mean that nonlinear refractive index is quite high compared to other materials. So it adds a lot of positive dispersion caused by self-phase modulation. So you need a lot of negative dispersion to balance all the nonlinearities. So we added specially designed mirrors. These are called double choke mirrors, and we use them. And in some mirrors we double bounce the beam to obtain more and more dispersion. And finally, we put our Sutter Bull absorber here in between two curved mirrors. Why we needed two curved mirrors? Because we wanted to have higher fluence so that we can saturate the Sutter Bull absorber and obtain a transparent operation mode for the Sutter Bull absorber. So this was the total experimental setup. And these two photographs shows an operating multipass cavity, which was taken by using an infrared camera. Here you can see that, as I explained, it makes multiple bounces. You can maybe see the notch here. You eject from here, and the last pulse, last beam is extracted from this notch. You can see that. Actually, it is not good to see that because it means that you have a lot of dust in your laboratory, and we had, unfortunately, but it's a cool picture. And so as a result, with this cavity extension, you had around 60 meters of cavity length, which corresponded to a 4.5 megahertz repetition rate, and total negative dispersion inside resonator was around minus 4440 femtosecond square. So this was the VCG, and this is the, by the way, name of the electrolyte. It is an, I don't know, the open version of it. It's the short name. And this is the transmission spectrum of the electrolyte. Of course, it should be transparent in the operation wavelength of the chromium phosphide so that it will not add any other loss to our resonator. Remember that we are trying to avoid losses. We want to control loss. Then after measuring the transmission of the electrolyte and we had the saturable absorber, we built our laser, placed the saturable absorber. We first characterized the continuous wave operation our laser, operation of our laser without any pulsing. So as you can see here, when we insert the device VCG at 0 volt, no bias, the output power was around that much. But if we increase the applied voltage slowly, you can clearly see that output power increases. And don't forget that the input power was same all times and output coupler percentage was never changed. So which means that by increasing the voltage, we were able to make this device more and more transparent for the photon energy of this chromium phosphide laser's operation wavelength. So up to certain point, it becomes not much transparent, not more transparent, because there is a certain limit. And as you can see, only few volts was enough to obtain this transparency. And similarly, we also measured the insertion loss. Since we were able to increase the output power, we can say that we were able to reduce the insertion loss of this device as we apply voltage. And this gray window here shows to you the femtosecond pulse generation range of this device. So here we can see that if you apply, for example, more than this much of voltage, more than 1 volt, you are no longer obtaining femtosecond pulses. The reason is that if you remember the energy band diagram with the Fermi level, so okay, it is good, we change the position of the Fermi level, device becomes transparent, but there is a limit. If it becomes completely transparent for 1.3 micron photon energy, then you no longer have this saturable absorption property because there are no carriers. You cannot carry your carriers from the valence band to conduction band anymore. So it becomes totally transparent. You don't want that because you need some kind of absorption to initiate this fast shatter action inside the laser resonator. So this was the limit for the saturable absorber. And I will show you one of the modlock operation results. We obtained modlock operation in each voltage up to 1 volt. This is the highest voltage modlock operation results. So remember basic characteristics of ultra short pulses. You have a, we have here pulse duration around 84 femtoseconds. And we have this spectrum here around 20 nanometers. So this was the time bandwidth product, multiplication of this space domain parameter with the time domain parameter. So it was equal to 0.32. So we can say that they were nearly solitary optical pulses. It is very close to the 0.315. And the measured pulse energy was 3.1 nanojoule. And peak power was around 37 kilowatts. You remember all these equations. This was output power divided by the repetition rate of the cavity. And this was the pulse energy divided by the pulse duration of the generated pulses. And this radio frequency spectrum also shows that our generated pulses were nearly 70 dB above the noise level, which indicates that we have a clear modlocked operation. So there was no disturbances with the continuous wave operation. It was clear. And we improved our design, as I said, and continue with the voltage-controlled graphene gold saturable absorber. By the way, as you can see here, these are not fantastic advanced devices. Very simple device. You have this substrates here and old PCB board, I guess, some cables. And they were very basic devices. So this is the photograph of the VCG gold. You can remember the structure, graphene electrode, electrolyte, and gold electrode with the notch. Similarly, with the same laser, we did continuous wave operation characterization first. And now, again, of course, similar action was observed. As you increase the voltage, output power increases, insertion loss decreases. But this is an improved version of this VCG because, as you can see here, we have a larger mode locking range, which is because we have a lower insertion loss even at the 0 volts of bias. Since we removed one of the graphene electrodes, now you don't have the loss of two graphene electrodes at zero bias. You have low loss. And again, for other voltages, you have only, you modulate the loss of one graphene. So it introduces less loss compared to our first design. And we obtained similar femtosecond pulse generation results. Again, sub 100 femtosecond pulses, near 20 nanometer spectrum, very good pulsing profile. And they were also close to solitary, ideal solitary optical pulses. Pulse energies and peak powers were also near the same, but slightly higher because now we have a less loss inside the resonator as a result of the improved design. And we, of course, wanted to increase our output peak power, pulse energy even further. So, but we encountered some power scaling limitations when we tried to increase the input power more and more, for example. While we were obtaining these pulses on the oscilloscope, they started to jiggle or they just collapsed suddenly. So we calculated the limits for further power scaling. The first point to look for is the critical power, of course. We started with this soliton area theorem. We knew the intracavity energy, pulse duration, added dispersion. So we calculated this gamma for this chromium four stride. In this gamma, you have nonlinear refractive index, lambda, crystal length, and the area, spot area inside the crystal. So this was our calculated result for the nonlinear refractive index of this material. And this was the one result from the literature. They are quite in agreement. So then by using this nonlinear refractive index in our laser, calculated from our laser parameters, we calculated the critical power by putting N2 to here. And we clearly saw that measured intracavity power was around 1.3 megawatts and calculated critical power for this nonlinear refractive index was around 1.5 megawatts. So, which indicates that we were reaching to this critical power limit. That's why we were observing pulsing instabilities. So this was the explanation for this laser. And then let's change the setup. As I said, we used two different setups because we want to test also the universality of this device. Now we will continue with the Thai Sapphire laser, which operates around 800 nanometer. It is a relatively simple setup. We were not, we did not care about the peak power increasing or anything. So we have a short cavity. And we, since this Thai Sapphire introduces less self-phase modulation compared to four-stride, prism pair was enough to control the dispersion inside the resonator. So we put the absorber here, similarly in between two curved mirrors, and performed continuous wave operation analysis first. Since the photon energy of the Thai Sapphire laser is higher because it is 800 nanometer compared to chromium four-stride, we could obtain mode locked operation also at higher voltages. It is expected from the physical laws, of course. You can clearly see that by increasing the voltage, we were able to increase the output power and similarly decrease the insertion loss for similarly with the chromium phosphate laser. And at the highest operation voltage of 1.2 volts, we were able to obtain sub 50 femtosecond pulses, nearly solitary profile, and a clear mode locking regime, let's say. So this was the mode lock operation results. Now I will jump to a slightly different topic. These experimental results were all done during my PhD studies. I was just investigating the femtosecond pulse generation capability of this device by using two different lasers. Of course, you don't have time or money to build every kind of laser to check its capability in every wavelength. So it is also important to provide a roadmap for this device, because we were the first group who demonstrated that this device can be used to generate femtosecond pulses from a laser. So we wanted to see how it behaves in the other wavelengths, and we used this pump probe spectrometer pumped with this 800 nanometer high power 100 femtosecond laser, and I conducted this study during my postdoctoral researcher activities. This is the inside photograph of the pump probe setup. Pump probe, by the way, means that you have pump here, pump laser comes here. This one produced the pump wavelength, let's say 300 nanometer. Probe, if you want a single wavelength probe, you also send your probe wavelength here. It goes through a delay range, so that when both encounter on the sample holder, pump comes, then you have a certain delay, time delay, probe comes, so that you can measure the lifetime or any other property time result by using this setup. We did not use single wavelength probe. Instead, we used 800 nanometer. Again, it passes through the delay stage. But here, there are some crystals. We generated continuum, white light continuum, which covers different wavelengths, so that at the same time, we can see the responses of many wavelengths. This is the femtosecond pump probe setup. These are all commercial, by the way. Okay, as I explained a few seconds ago, this is the basic of a femtosecond pump probe spectroscopy. You have your pump laser here. You have a chopper here in the optical path of the pump laser. You have continuum here, and it has some delay. As you can see, it comes through a delay stage. You have your sample. Also, you put some of the continuum to the reference detector, so that you also check your continuum is still okay or not. While you put a chopper here, it determines the delta A. Delta A here means that pumped absorbance minus unpumped absorbance. Pumped means that pump comes, chopper is open, it reaches to the sample, it excites to carriers to an upper level, then probe comes and photographs that scenario. In the unpumped case, chopper closes the pump, there is no pump, so graphene, for example, is in its steady state, no excitation. Again, probe comes, then records the unpumped absorbance in those wavelengths. And these were the spectrum of this continua we used in the experiments. We used visible and near infrared. And this was one of our other saturable absorber devices. So let's come to the experimental results. So I will keep this equation here because it is important. Delta A refers to pumped minus unpumped absorbance. Here you can see that voltage dependent delta A in the visible range and in the near infrared range. And up to this point, delta A, by the way, minus here means that your unpumped absorption is higher than the pumped absorption, which means that your device can act as a saturable absorber. So if there is no pump, you can still, because you don't excite anything, you can still excite carriers from valence to conduction. So it has absorption larger than the pumped scenario. So minus means that negative delta A, which refers to saturable absorption, if your delta A is positive, which can refer to multiphoton absorption. Let's say this wavelength photon energy is not enough because it is occupied up to this point, and delta A positive means that pump absorption greater than unpumped absorption, which means that your pump already came here, block all the things, it carried the electrons here. So longer wavelengths can no longer be absorbed. They are just passes through the sample. You will need a shorter wavelength, higher photon energy to achieve this absorption. So delta A greater than zero in the pump prop experimental scenario means that you have multiphoton absorption. And let's look at the experimental results here. For example, take 650 nanometer for the visible. As expected, it acts as a saturable absorber up to this voltage. But after a certain voltage, it becomes as a you observe multiphoton absorption. Why? Because by applying voltage, you shift the Fermi level here. Now it is transparent. There is no absorption for this photon energy. But still, as you can see, there is saturable absorption for shorter photon, shorter wavelength, higher photon energy. Let's look at 750. It becomes multiphoton absorption range quicker than 650. Why? Because it has a longer wavelength. It is already occupied for this wavelength. Of course, similar results were obtained for the near infrared wavelengths, and compared to the visible, you can say that, for example, for 1200 nanometer orange here, around 1 volt, it starts multiphoton absorption, which also clearly explains why we were not able to obtain, for example, pulse generation if we go beyond 1 volt by using this chromium four-stripe laser. It also explained this here clearly. This was the cross section of the data, and this is the full data we obtained from the pump probe experiment. So pump was around 470 nanometers. This bar means that this color refers to the increased voltage, and you have the wavelength range here. How to read these graphs? For example, let's look at the near infrared version. For 1000 nanometer wavelength, you have up to, let's say, green here, green colors, around 1 volt, you have saturable absorption. But if you go further, for example, here 1.25, you start to observe multiphoton absorption. As I said, these are the cross sections of this data. They show both things. Similarly for the visible wavelengths. So we checked the absorption map of the device in the near infrared and visible. But as I mentioned in the previous slides, there are also two other important parameters. One of them is the carrier recombination time, and the other one is saturation fluence for a saturable absorber. So we also wanted to check that whether by increasing the voltage, this carrier lifetime is affected or saturation fluence is affected. I will show you a few results we measured in each continuum wavelength. So for example, for 750 nanometer, we can say that for 0 volt, 0.8 volt and 1 volt, they were carrier recombination time were nearly the same and of the order of few picoseconds, which is good news. So you can use this device as a fast saturable absorber. It is not affected by the voltage. And similarly for the near infrared, we obtained a slight change, but again, it was of the order of few volts. So it can be used as a fast saturable absorber. When we look at the saturation characteristics, how we measured it, we had our sample. Now we fix the pump wavelength and probe wavelength, but we increased the fluence of the incident pump. So this is for 650 nanometer, this is for 1000 nanometer. So for 0 volt, we increased the fluence, measured the saturation fluence for this device. And similarly, we did it for the near infrared. As we can see here, when we increase the voltage, it reduces monotonically a little bit. But then after you reach the limit, you shift the Fermi level that much so that it becomes transparent for the 650 nanometer. It starts to increase dramatically and modulation depth decreases also. Similarly for the 1000 nanometer, this means that if you increase the voltage more and more, you leave the saturation property. As I explained before, you need a little bit, at least a little bit amount of saturation at a low saturation fluence so that you can obtain this shutter action, so that it can modulate the loss of your laser resonator. So it is kind of good and bad news because up to a limit, okay, it is okay, but you cannot increase the voltage even further. And this was the fit formula that we used for these equations. You can check the article if you wish. Okay, so this is the last graph, and it is the combination of the all pump probe data. This is the roadmap graph for this device, shows the universality of this device, which means that you can use this device as a modulator to generate femtosecond pulses with a controllable loss at a lower cutoff wavelength of 630 nanometer, because you remember maybe from here, let's say, yes, up to this nanometer. Below that, it is not no longer act as a saturable absorber. And then, for example, if you have a 1000 nanometer laser, your limit is around 1 volt. If you have a 800 nanometer laser, it is slightly above 1 volt. 700, like 1.5 volts. It will give you some idea about your upper voltage limit. By the way, this blank here is because of we used two different continuums and they don't overlap at certain wavelengths. Okay, finally we came to the conclusions. So what we did during this research in my PhD and postdoctoral studies, we used a unique supercapacitor design which allows you to have reversible and dynamic control over the insertion loss of graphene in a broad wavelength range from visible to near infrared and at low bias voltages compared to its solid state counterparts. And this all three works with VCG and VCG Gold. They were the first demonstrations of such devices for the generation of femtosecond pulses from solid state lasers. And during the later, in the later works, we investigated the saturable and multiphoton absorption characteristics of this device. And we saw that this device can be used as a fast saturable absorption. It has a quite good carrier recombination time and saturation fluence in an ultra broad range of 630 and 1460 nanometer. And we can conclude it like that. We can say that such architectures can be used. They have the potential to be used as versatile saturable absorbers in lasers with low gain, low output powers. And you can use it in many different lasers without changing the fabrication technique. Thank you for your attention. Now I will stop sharing.
Greetings to all and all who are attending this seminar. It has been a great pleasure to propose the word of thanks. First and foremost, I'd like to thank the Dr. Isin Subbailam, who was the best last meeting. So, it was very helpful to share the knowledge with us, speaking about the session. It was about graphene and graphene-based devices, its properties on how it can be used as a saturable absorber to semiconductors to generate short pulses from lasers, and supercapacitors from graphenes. Its unique optical properties, the ability to charge the chain, its ability to change the Fermi level to absorb the desired wavelength, and etc. And the various doped graphenes, and she also gave insight into the detailed physics of the device, the voltage controlled graphene, saturation absorber, etc. So speaking about graphene sees a much higher scope in future physics in the rapid progress of technology. And technology, if it's used for the well-being and sustenance of mankind, should progress much beyond. If it weren't for the help of technology, we wouldn't be having this meeting right now. And I'm concluding my words by thanking my friends and teachers who's attending the seminar. Principal, MMO Department, Physics MMO Department, OSA Coordinator Shoyusa, and Dr. Bigelam once again. Thank you.